Welcome back, everybody, into your coverage of the MLG TKO. We are now into our third game coming out from the European Series for tonight. We have a full 8 games in store for you, 4 US, 4 EU. But of course, for now, we are looking to see if we can finally confirm if there will be a tiebreaker match tomorrow. VP, no matter how they perform in this matchup, they have found themselves out of this competition, but there is still pride in the line for them to fight up against Sigma. And of course, Sigma, there's a lot more on the line. They must win this game to force a tie break between Sigma and Power Rangers tomorrow evening. So let's, without any further ado, get ourselves over into the game. And here we are. And I say we because it is not a solo me. It is a we because we are together. It is Sneyking and myself. Welcome to VP versus Sigma.
Indeed. I am with you, Toby.
I'm glad. Or else we'd be having a problem right now. Because we'd be like, introducing to you my imaginary friend, Sneyking.
No one will think you're crazy, because you already are. Alright, but on our hands right now, in this game, we should... VP definitely should be able to study what happened last game with Sigma, so they should be prepared for this Ember Spirit. Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't take too much effort just to take a look and join Dota, and just take a look at the hero picks last game. So,
I was talking to Matt about that during the break, by the way. Because I was just like, hey, man, like, Mag? Have you thought about using Mag? Because Fate also loves Magnus, and he basically said, "Yeah, it's insanely powerful." But one thing he mentioned was map control, and that was where you can consider the Beastmaster coming in with the high points up in the Hawk. You're able to give that vision to Ember Spirit to gank around the map or to come in, come out, and you let him know where he can fight straight from the get go. But I'm interested to see if they're going to mix it up or not, because that glass cannon with also in a power buff up, holy Hannah, you would die instantly. And someone like an Invoker, Quas will not protect him. But Invoker is going to be the first pick up here from VP nonetheless.
Yeah, but Invoker is very good at team fighting, especially Quas Wex, very easily able to gank up that mid lane. So Fada should be having a pretty rough time if he ever gets roamed on. And Quaswex is also very good. That the mana burn is very good, and especially versus Ember Spirit with a very low mana pool, one EMP and you're pretty much out of mana. You can't spam that sleight of fist like you usually want to do, and you can't even escape because your mana is burned. So maybe we wouldn't see Ember Spirit, but who knows? Maybe that we'll still see it. But nonetheless, Invoker is a very strong first pick.
Yeah, that is, as always, man. I'm always happy when Invoker gets picked up. I'm always, always happy because it makes for an entertaining middle lane and a dynamic middle lane as well. So that's the first one for NS. Now he's going to work out what he's going to couple it up with, because Clockwork and Visage being picked up, he knows he's dealing with long range initiation. He knows he's going to be dealing with an element of split push coming out from the Visage, not to mention the DPS and team fight control that comes out from those birds. But my question is, does VP try and go in for like their off lane? They go for Ancient Apparition, the support to start with, because like Nature's Prophet hasn't been selected yet. We haven't been seeing any kind of split push coming out from VP, and I was wondering if they were just going to go all in for a fight. And AA does kind of lean down that line a little bit more.
Yeah, and this is quite early of an Ancient Apparition pick. We usually see it on the third pick, but VirtusPro already picked it, so they're not afraid to show this Ancient Apparition. And they have a lot of options on what they want to do after that as well. They're completely open to aggressive and defensive tri-lanes with Ancient Apparition pick. And Reaver and Pugna are banned out respectively. So I guess they're afraid of the death push from Sigma with the Pugna plus another pusher, Death Prophet or something like that, which Sigma has ran before. 10 seconds and remaining. Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, I understand that death push. That Pugna would be anywhere with Sigma. But they haven't taken the Ember. They still haven't. Maybe they feel confident up against the Ember. The Ember. Like, would you be confident up against the Ember Spirit? Because you still understand he's a glass cannon. Like you already said before, Invoker's great at controlling. AA, also to a point, has some nice DPS, so when they do have a chance to hit him, they're going to hit very, very hard. So, VP will be taking out the Lich. So they're still thinking a little bit more about lane control coming out from Sigma. But, yeah.
Yeah. I don't think they know what they want to do, and Sigma wants to play reactionary with their current draft, but they're not getting much information out of VP right now. So VP is really in the driving shoes position right now, because they're going to be able to counterpick whatever Sigma picks right now. And then Sigma will be playing another reaction game of what they pick.
Well, Fader, give us your first reaction at least. Slark was their last ban out here. So taking out one of a lot of people's favorites, Miguel loves that hero, VP, they've dabbled with it a little bit too. And they just start with the Beastmaster, so we won't get our Magnus combo. But the Beastmaster does come up here as a third pickup. So this lineup is looking very familiar, isn't it? Very familiar.
These exact three heroes, I think it's the same order as well, in which they're now.
They went Ember Spirit was third. Picked
third. Yeah. Pretty much the same order as Pika's last game. I mean, VP has to be expecting it, or keeping it in the back mind at least.
Well, they go for the CM, and that's not a hero which you want up against. Okay, Fader's not going to hold back here. You got an Ancient Apparition and a Crystal Maiden. If this Ember Spirit gets even a remote amount of farm, he's just going to fist down the CM in the AA.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, this AA and CM and Invoker, very low armor intelligence heroes. And I don't know, it seems like this is a very good game for Ember Spirit, and it can also be very poor because of this Invoker. So it's all about this Invoker, honestly, whether how well VirtusPro does. Because if this Invoker starts to fall behind, not get enough levels on the Quas Wex, so the EMP Tornado is actually not effective, then Sigma's going to crush these support heroes in teamfights, because if they ever miss a Tornado or EMP, you already lost half your teamfight potential.
Yeah, agreed. Agreed heavily. But Fader seems to be... He's not with the same decision. Like, we're making this assumption it's going to be Ember-based, just based on our previous game, which we had from Sigma. They may be worried that VP's making this too predictable. Because it does kind of feel that way. It's like, well, VP know the weakness they're showing right now to Sigma. There has to be more to it. There must be more to it. They can't have just said, nah, well, we're playing up against Fnatic in a two-game series. We didn't check out the draft from the last game Sigma played. Like, you wouldn't do that. You would look before you fought.
Yeah, it only takes seconds to look up the lineup, especially when everything is stayed on the website, joinDOTA.
The wonderful plugging. I didn't even have to plug the website tonight. You've been great.
10 seconds remaining. Yeah.
But it is a beautiful thing to look at right now with the community live stream, because we had all three of our live streams up. The community, the MLG one we're on right now, and the Daily Motion live stream. All three streams were firing on all six cylinders this evening. So I hope you've been enjoying the awesome coverage coming out from joinDOTA. We've really, over the last month, just stepped up our A game as far as what we're bringing you coverage for. And hopefully in a month it's going to be even better.
THD. This hero has not seen many pickups, but whenever he's played, he has decent results.
Well, if you look at it, like, I'm still thinking Ember. If NS doesn't ban it out here in the fifth selection, I just don't know what the hell. But you got a Visage and a Jakiro on the mix. So you've got one, or you basically got two slows in there, and then you've got the Ice Path follow-up. So Beastmaster Roar into Ice Path could also be set up by your initial damage, which comes from the Ember Spirit's done. And then you've got a Clockwork who can also hook shot in, lock people inside cogs, and then you got Macropyre on top of that one. You got familiar drop bombs on top of that one. Axes as well. Sigma's lineup has a lot of single target focus initiations and a lot of AoE follow up. And VP, go with a Tidehunter, a hero that's going to get completely zoned out of his lane.
I'm trying to think of the reason behind this.
You could try Tide versus Beast in the mid. That'll be nice. But then Sigma could just mix it up as well and put Beastmaster into their offlane kind of role and put Clockwork in the mid. And then just put whatever they want to put now here as their last one. It's a gamble. So I'm not a massive Tidehunter fan. There was a period of maybe 1 to 2 months when I was, and that was in the Hannah Montana era. But after that, Tidehunter for me just dropped off because it just takes so long to get him up in level, so to have like a important Ravage that isn't just spoiled by BKBs.
Yeah, and I'm not sure, honestly, I'm not sure where this Tyranitar is supposed to fit in this lineup. But there's also another thing they can do is try to aggressive trialing the Instant Apparition, Crystal Maiden, Tidehunter. If they're expecting a very greedy pick from Sigma right here, and just have a double slow setup for the cold feed, and then the finisher with the chilling touch, and it's a lot of damage. I can see where that trialing happening, but I'm not sure if there is a late game plan from VirtusPro if they do so desire to go that route.
Well, I still can't believe it to take it out, and we get Tinker. I love how Sigma has a no ban.
Oh, yeah, I was like, huh?
Yeah.
Where's the ban?
Yeah, Fatal let it tick out. So we're actually going to get Tinker, Beastmaster, Kuro, Visage, and Clockwork. So we get a Tinker-Hawk combo. So this is Tinker jumping everywhere across the map. Probably be looking to hard farm up that Tinker as well. Because then if you get that Aghanim Scepter up and running, Crystal Maiden, Ancient Apparition, good luck surviving. I really wish him the best of luck to survive. And Morphling as the final pickup here from VP. Is it just me or is VP walking on a very, very tight rope right now?
I mean, all their heroes are like, I don't know, all blue, I guess. So that's a good thing.
Well, I think Tidehunter would disagree. He has a blue background, but he is rather green.
So it is going to be an offlane Tidehunter.
Oh, what a very nice set. Like, what is that headpiece?
On who?
On the Crystal Maiden, the Hood of the Frozen Feather. It's very nice.
New Bloom.
Yeah. Oh, is it? Yeah.
Yeah, it is. But this Tidehunter, I haven't seen Tidehunter offlane in a while, and that's like back in my days when I played offlane. That's how long it has been, really, since I've seen Tidehunter off lanes. But it can be very effective, especially with the two buffs that Kraken Shell has received. I mean, it used to be scaling very poorly, 7, 14, 21, 28 for the amount of damage reduction it does. But two patch later, it was 8, 16, etc. And then this patch, recent patch, it got buffed again. It reduces 10 damage each time, and it lowers a damage threshold.
It's at this point, though, I then point out just Liquid Fire is still just going to screw with him. Ice Pass going to screw with him. Visage is going to screw with him. He shouldn't get experience on the offlane. Like, the Tidehunter, which the reason why it almost phased out, is because she had to try and hide the guy to get some experience. So even Demon was one of the most renowned for doing it, would like walk his way down through the tree line, and then, like, hide himself in this little box area. I can't draw it for you right now. I can. On the minimap, you'll see it. Down here on the bottom lane. So, or you'd hide yourself over in this little, like, nook and cranny here in the tree line over here. This was basically your only options for the Tidehunter when you're running on an off lane. The change to the creep wave now means that you can't even hide there, because it pulls the creep wave even further up. So maybe you can just leech a little bit more experience while hiding close towards your tower. But, I still question the offlane pickup, and I want to watch it closely to see just how successful Smile will be with it.
Yeah, and I'm personally very intrigued on how this tanker is going to do in this game, because I have yet to see Morphling in a long time. And Tinker versus Morphling, it's like whoever shotguns or like Dagon's the other is gonna die. It's like it's a very intense matchup. Because both heroes are very squishy but with very high nuke powers. So it's honestly whoever gets the first jump will always be able to two shot the other. But perhaps maybe they'll prove me wrong, but I don't know. It's gonna be interesting to watch that interaction.
It will be fun. I'm not seeing Morphling coming out on top of all of that just because of Beastmaster and Clockwork. Like, one-on-one, Tinker versus Morphling, I can understand the matchup as whoever does the boom-boom first. But when it comes to Sigma, when you got a hookshot that can fly in, you got a Beastmaster who, like in the last game, ended up going for a Blink Dagger. So we're looking at a Beastmaster Roar coming the way of the Morphling 2 to control him. you can see him dead instantly, and then your physical DPS has to come from Invoker. Will be like the last one that'll be left there. Tidehunter's not going to really do it for you. Like, he does a Ravage and then goes, oh, okay, did I kill anybody? It's like, wait, no, I'm going up against a support hero that has one of the highest base strength increases in the game, which is the Jakiro, and then a Visage should be walking around with his Gravekeeper's Cloak as well. So, two very difficult support heroes to kill off. So even if the Ravage hits, Sigma won't even need BKBs to survive it. They'll need to just make sure that mech is up and running very early on. Which means no delaying it this time around. But knowing Fate as Beastmaster, he does really prefer to go into that mech. Even if we didn't see it. Early tonight, that is.
I'm interested to see if VP are going to land the Dream combo. Sort of a Tornado into a Ravage into Ancient Aboriginal, Crystal Maiden all. Everything will blow up if landed perfectly. But I don't think Sigma will give him the Dream combo that I just spoke of. But VP is definitely going to try their best to get it, and I expect a Blink Dagger or a Force Staff rush on Smile, maybe after Mechanism, but I don't see him getting that much farm, and they really need the initiation, so he should be rushing it. Especially with the Blink Dagger buff, it doesn't cost any mana to use it, so you can actually even skip Arcane Boots to get that combo going.
Well, I'm kind of hoping that we get our Tinker back inside the game very, very quickly. So, having to reboot at some random time, but at least Sigma has five players in tonight. They're standing. He did really well. He did really well. This W33 guy. And, like, do you know the name from somewhere else? It's
Weeha. That's his name. He's a streamer as well. I believe that's him. I can check his profile. I don't know why I didn't have done that. But I'm pretty sure that's him. I don't see Sigma just using some random stand-in.
Yeah, especially for such critical games as well. Right now we have him labeled up as an unknown stand-in. But if it is Weeha, we should be making profiles for him. So for the guy who's tuning in right now, who is abandoning the match, go make a profile.
Yeah, it is him. I just looked up his profile and it is him. So, good to know.
Yeah. So what else? Like, he's just a pub streamer.
Yeah, he plays a lot and he's pretty high in the MMR bracket as well. So, but he doesn't get that many views. So slightly underrated and under the radar sort of kind of player. But he's definitely notice he's a very skilled player from just how he plays. Like, whether from his stream or Dota TV, because of his high MMR, he's often featured on the top 5 games.
I'll have to watch him a little bit closer right now. It's always good to keep eyes on the upcoming talent out there.
Yeah, Dota scene is honestly sort of a difficult thing to get into. Once you're known, you're always going to be known. But if you're unknown, you're always going to remain unknown.
But it normally takes like that one big game though to let you be known. Like, that's where Abra Bulldog came from. He played with Na'Vi before he ended up going with Alliance, and that's how he became popular. He was picked up by Dendi. They said, "Wow, this guy's really good at a lone druid," and so they got him to play it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess all that happened because of Dendi, and I guess Dendi lost some TI.
Are you saying it was Denny's own fault that he lost TI because he found Admiral Bulldog and made him public in the scene?
Indeed. I mean, it's pretty evident that they lost because Bulldog was just such a superior player at TI. I mean, not I'm discrediting Na'Vi or anything, but
Bulldog was playing awesome.
Yeah, he was definitely playing his A game. Every single game is profit, regardless of situation, always like first in net worth. You rarely see him otherwise.
Smile's being really over-aggressive here on Matt. I'm really surprised Matt didn't just go for Liquid Fire at level 1. I've seen a lot of Jakiros these days just like bypass the Ice Path and go 2 points up into Liquid Fire, or 2 points up in the Breed Fire, sorry, and 1 point up in the Liquid Fire, or vice versa. They just turn themselves into harassment lanes, harassment heroes for the lane, so you can completely zone somebody out, while Pass does exactly this. Like, he's stacked, and now he's pulling.
The good thing about Liquid Fire is that You can actually, since the recent patch, you can manually toggle who
misses
wants to
completely
go.
On Smile. Yeah. If that hit, they would have had a little bit more time to dish out some damage. But also notice too, Tinker hasn't leveled anything up yet. Like, he's waiting for the right time for the right ability.
Yeah, he's not going to probably not ever skill until it's going to go for a kill, or he just feels like skilling up a laser or rocket just for harassment. See, there's just really no reason to. You can always just save your skill points for degree, forward points in March of Machines, and just clear up stacks or just jungle camps in general, and then get the very fast boot to travel, global presence that Sigma's looking to do with the Hawk and Tinker combination.
I'm surprised Faye just made the mistake he did in the mid. Like, he's still trying to get himself to a bottle, but he basically popped off the healing salve and then came in range of God, so he only got about half of the salve completed when he healed up, because God initiated on him. Like, it's easy. You just go in for that cold snap, and all of a sudden Fader loses most of his life points. With Crystal Maiden rotating in as well, and they should be able to get a kill. Tornado up into the air, CM with a frostbite, and that's first blood going to the Crystal Maiden in the middle lane.
Yeah, and Fada didn't get his bottle delivered to him. Like, this is going to be a very rough matchup, especially after a gank like that. Because the nature of Invoker Quaswex is that once he's got his early levels in face boots, it's impossible to try to trade regen efficiently or to zone him out of lane. Like, and it's very easy to gank for a Quaswex Invoker. You just cold snap first or you tornado first, whichever one, follow up with a EMP. And then your support is guaranteed to be able to cast your spells and land whatever difficult stun it may be, or just a simple Nova freeze by Crystal Maiden in this scenario.
Mm-hmm. I want to point out the difference between the carries right now as far as their CS goes. Tinker's keeping up pretty close to it, but Morphling is still just inching himself ahead. 20 for 9 up against the 18 for 11 lane. But also, probably more importantly, is Tidehunter. 2.5 levels on him compared to the 2.5 levels over on Miguel. Obviously, level 6 is important for both of them, but like for Tidehunter, he kind of needs farm to also succeed. Just hoping you get the Ravage off in the middle of a team fight isn't enough. He needs Blink, he needs Force, or something along these lines if he's really going to do something.
Yeah, and while Clockwork only needs to hit level 6 and then he can actually start ganking. So it's going to be very, very different. But Tidehunter is going to be very good for his Clockwork hookshots when they do initiate. He can easily teleport in, drop the Ravage for counter initiation purposes, and completely turn the engagement around. So I can see both of these offlanes doing a fair amount of work. It will just depend a lot on how they're going to be laning and when are they going to hit their level 6.
Yeah, that's a very good question, man. Right now, I still give a little bit more props to Miguel for probably getting level 6. I say props, a little bit more res, bank behind it. But Smile has managed to crack level 3. Moving now to check out some runes, but he's going to find the two smoked up dragons, Visage as well as Shakiro. So they could, if they want to, lock him into a corner right now. And that's exactly what they're going to try and do. But Ice Path from Matt, again, is going to go astray. The pass as well as Matt, they're going to team up together here. No soul assumption damage can be thrown out while a middle lane Fader goes down again. Jotam as well as Sergei team up for that one. And that was even when Fader had his double boars up and running.
It's impossible to dodge these ganks, and he's just going to keep being ganked. There's nothing you can do. Just has to be a little bit more careful, I guess. But just like that, Invoker is very far ahead in the net worth wise, and he just picked up the Bracer, so he's going for the drum build. There's no Midas shenanigans or anything from him today.
We're looking at fast movement speed, fight early on, so drums, Yule Scepter, that kind of jazz. Get him on the front lines, because that's exactly where he's got to be. If he keeps Fader locked down, stops the Splink Dagger from arriving, you remove out that big initiation from Sigma, and then you've got you free up heroes to battle up against the Tinker. And this is a Tinker who's 100 gold away from finishing up BTs. Like, this is danger zone right now. And Smile's pulling a demon. He's hiding in the tree line for this perfect position.
Yeah, indeed. And right now, Fada is scared to even go out for a single CS. He's only CSing the boar. And top lane, Morphling gets a kill. That's a pretty big kill. Clockwork's only level 3. And like you said, Smile is getting his feet of experience, and he's going to be happy about the current situation.
Yeah. Well, why not? Pass is looking.
Middle lane?
Yeah, they're looking to change up this middle lane. With that haste rune from Pass, the initiation from Fader with a roar into the ice path. But Tornado and EMP is going to go off, and then Sergei just jumps Invis. They're all out of mana. They don't really have that many life points to dive underneath the tower. And Sigma's initiation gets completely shut down.
Amazing play from God right there. The Soul Assumption was going to come momentarily because he was trying to hold it for the maximum damage. But then he actually ghost walked before it even went off, and Pass just got mana burn. And that was a 600 mana that God spent right there. But he only actually spent about 150 because he mana burned them for so much. And this is creating a lot of space for Smile to farm up in this bottom lane and get experience. Because the supports are completely zoomed and has to return back to base. And both of them are trying to go back to the lane now. But they're both really under level. Crystal Maiden's 5.5 levels, almost level 6. Sitting on par with the Beastmaster, basically, which is the enemy mid-cell lane. Ancient Apparition's almost level 5. So he's going to hit that level 6 very soon. And be able to send those Ice Blast towards the middle lane and make Fada's life even more miserable.
I would still point out, though, that Tinker has BTs up 7 minutes into this game. So moments like this bottom, where Smile gets almost destroyed. Stick charges keep him alive, but laser rockets and one basic attack was enough to get rid of the life points he had when that initiation started from W33. But now W33 realizes the problem of going BTs this early on without having a soul ring. He's stranded for the moment until he has enough. The cooldown comes off for his BTs. He's stranded.
Yeah. You often run into mana problems when trying to do something like this. And this is why I personally really like a bottle and soul ring, even though it's not you're not mid solo. It just helps you regenerate and keep your consistency on Tinker so much. Because the bottle in base it allows you to heal like almost at double your speed for mana and health. And so it just gets you out of base much quicker, which increases your farm efficiency. Then Soul Ring, it's pretty self-explanatory. It gives you mana, and mana on Tinker is really good.
Yeah. He's already rearming and getting ready to go back to base. In fact, there he goes right now. There was a prep gank being set up in the middle lane, and S was coming in to try and help out Sergei. And with Jotam just behind him too, it would have been possible. But I don't know if you've been watching the jungle camps, but there's been a lot of stacking going on. The Aegis is basically a triple stack right now, which is being farmed up by Tinker. And there's another stack, which is looks also like a triple stack, which is just next to the Tier 2 tower as well.
Yeah. So Tinker's going to be able to farm these stacks pretty easily now with the Soul Ring online and multiple levels in the March of the Machines. And this is, I honestly really favor this kind of playstyle, where your hard carry is able to transition out of lane and then you give the support the whole lane to farm and to catch up and experience and gold. It's honestly a very nice thing. It increases your map efficiency farming by a lot.
And it helps even more when the Tidehunter abandons the bottom lane. Now you get a Tinker on the map which you know can come in at any point, but it's the fact that Tide went jungle to try and farm up. The Hawk scouts out the fact that Jotam and Smile moved up north. But at the same time, if they just keep going up there, it won't matter. NS as well as Illidan are about to hit onto the tier one tower. For the first time, this tower takes damage. And the fortification will trigger. Miguel comes up to try and defend, but with those 5 points up in the chilling touch, Illidan already knows he can hit like an absolute truck. But Tinker's already here. There's a Martian Machines behind the tower. So no one wants to come in from the side. And they know there's still rockets and laser, even if there is a waveform in. Chilling touch won't help you if you have 100% miss chance. So they go for the easier kill. Rotation bottom lane.
Yeah, indeed. And things are slowing down right now, but I think it's about to get picked up. This bottom lane. Crystal Maiden. He's ready. If he catches Tinker right there. Oh, man.
There's the Nova. There is still the March of the Machines going down. The EMP burn into a call snap and the frostbite. Some really good damage being done to the Tinker. But they still didn't get the kill, and up on top lane, Illidan can't seem to kill off a Clockwork, who's TP back to base.
Yeah, it's kind of wasted efforts, because the Tinker is just going to regenerate anyways. So you sort of have to kill him in one blow, or you just don't go at all. But Illidan sitting at very low HP. But there is no surprising burst, but maybe there is. Tinker's TPing in.
Yeah, and the Ice Blast is going to be too far away. Lasers and Rocket, we see him strength morph up rather quickly. Illidan jumping himself up to 900 life points. And the top tower will be denied. And the T1 towers aren't really a major problem for Sigma. When you're running around with a Tinker, who's already like BTing, Sol Ringing, bottling 11 and a half minutes into this game, you know you're going to be okay. Now, Illidan's forced out of the lane just by rockets, and we still have to go back to, we're talking about the possibility of what Ember Spirit could do to these supports, these heroes who are low on life, but we haven't even talked about just the harassment potential of the Tinker, and just how much VP need to have either mech or a whole lot of supports behind him to make sure they either fight the Tinker or run away and survive from the Tinker.
Yeah, and Tinker doesn't have his Blink Dagger yet, so he's still very vulnerable to ganks, and I would like to see something happen to him. I mean, Smiles is already level 6, so they can definitely teamfight, but Mad middle lane, Invis, and there is no Sentry to spawn him out.
Well, his Ice Pass have been a little bit off target recently, so he's going to try. See if he can hit God right now. He's going to come at the perfect time. God as well as Jotam. It's only the Crystal Maiden that gets controlled by this. The call snap did go over. Is that Naeoldi coming in? Oh, Fader! He's just far enough south. The attack up the hill missing from God, which means that healing sound still working from the Jakiro, and he wants to give at least one last Ice Path up. A little bit too short with the familiar drop downs. Stuns onto Sergei. He jumps invis, and now in comes the Ravage from Smile onto the Tinker, as well as Jakiro, killing off the Jakiro. And now Tinker with March Machine's cover fire. He's able to kill off the Crystal Maiden. One last rocket. The creep wave will kill him off. Smile is running from the boar. I don't know why he didn't just retreat straight away. Either way, it's €3 for the price of one. And Sergei's looking for that one last pickoff over on Fader. And he moves so fast. But he's not fast enough.
Yeah, he's not going to get it, but he does see the stack. So maybe he'll camp there and wait for Tinker to get back and just surprise gank him. But I want to talk about how unfortunate the AA blast was. It barely missed Fader because he just stepped out of the range and Jakir wasn't yet to step in the range, so both of those heroes kind of survived that fight, but by a very bare margin.
Well, everyone's now coming back into the middle lane. Blink Dagger, Beastmaster, Initiation. If he can only just see up towards that high ground and see Sergei there, he would just jump it. And back there she goes! Vision's there, Familiar's in from the side, and God! That was a very, very short life after what's been a very difficult hero to kill in the middle lane.
Yeah, and he almost has his 4-staff, so maybe next time it'll be slightly different. Maybe he'll get the 4-staff off as the roar goes off, or even before it. But in the meanwhile of all of this, Morphling is still uncontested in farm. He's almost has his Lincoln Sphere and Treads, which is quite a significant amount of farm. And the Tinker is sort of stagnant a little bit, but he is going to be able to pick up the Blink Dagger in quite short.
I don't know if you're watching Jotun right now, trying to survive up against the boar, but he's getting harassed down by the boar. The familiars are then coming in from the side. And this Crystal Maiden is dying to basically, well,
bottom lane
summons. That's it. Yeah, this is going to be fast getting hit by the AA ulti, but they need more follow-up than just an AA ulti. And Tornado,
maybe he's getting it.
Little bit off target, but Call Snap as well as the EMP. Plus, let's take a lot of damage. He's got 8-1 charges, which will still keep him alive.
Yeah, the power of that one level in the Graveskeeper cloak, he might have actually shattered it without it. But Tinker farming the jungle camps, he might be able to get out of this. He might not. We don't know yet. And he's greedy. He's staying for it. He's going to pay.
Yep. Already with a call snap, and he has BTs, but being stunned up so much, he'll go down. They had three heroes ready to commit for that, and if they had to, they had a Ravage as well.
Yeah, and Crystal made an ulti, so there was really no way for him to survive, but Pass, oh man, he's spotted out.
TP, Ravage committed.
Worth it.
And show us the kill, but now there's two TPs coming in, Blink into a roar. Over onto Sergei, creates the ball to slow him down to Ice Path. There's no Macro Pie, there's just the Dual Breath right now. And Familiar drop down, buying some space. But Jakiro, is he going to die from the fall right now? Yes, he does. And Ness also wasn't looking too massively healthy after that. But Miguel has hook shot and he's not going in.
Yeah, that was a very poor play from Sigma right there. Fada probably expected more damage to be coming out. But this is a level 5 Jakiro without Macro Pile. It's like he barely does any damage. And just like that, God almost has his four staff. Now, if you go anyone besides God with the Beastmaster War, you're going to have quite a difficulty trying to focus him down, because he'll just get four. Whoever gets Roar will get four staff, and then a Tornado EMP will be on its way from Invoker, and then you can't even fight because you're out of mana on half your team.
And then you're going to have Morphling come in, who will have his Lincoln Sphere fully done, and go, hey, you've just used all your abilities on my teammates. I can kill you all off as well. So this really does turn into a game where you've got to split push it. It's the only option for Sigma right now. They've got to take map control advantage. Right now they're still behind a little bit, but they have a lineup which can initiate really nicely, but they just don't have the strength of their lineup right now to do it. Not in comparison where VP's currently at. Even with now a fresh Blink Dagger over on the Tinker.
Yeah, and this is actually quite late of a Blink Dagger, considering there's so much stacks in the jungle and ancients from the farm. And that two devs really slowing him down. As we can see, his net worth in comparison to Morphling, it is comparable, but he is behind.
Yeah.
The bottom lane right now.
There's your AA Aldi coming down. Nice Tornado. Caught Miguel out. He's still got a hookshot available. He's basically only got one option. Use it and go balls deep. With the Macropyre now up, they should be able to burn out NS here, which they do so successfully. And then some Martian Machines. Jotam trying to hide in the corner. He doesn't have his own four stuff up just yet. So still only a one-for-one trade, but they found him with the familiars. So Jotam,
Morphling
there's a TP coming in though from the Tinker. So Morphling will start attacking. You see his Fader. No, his BT's up and running. Blinks up. But with Sergei here as well, they're really not sure they want to stick around. And there goes your Tinker dying in the corner. New Tornado hitting on both the dragons. First the Visage to die, then also the Jakiro. And Fader, Ravage, who's still in the neighborhood, he throws down the axes, but he can't finish off Sergei. He's in the corner. The familiars finally do the job for it. But Morphling is farming these guys up. Miguel comes back into the game. Cogs up on Smile. The Smile, Anchor Smash, Gush being available. Illidan's hitting the AOD as well off target. But it's an ultra kill for Illidan. A 6-0-1 Morphling. Now 18 and a half minutes into this game, Lincoln Sphere is already done, and a huge injection of money to bring him to 9.5k on the net worth.
Yeah, this is going to be a free tower for him as well, so he's very close to this Ethereal Blade. And a this is going to be a 325 minute Ethereal Blade. This is very scary. I mean, if he does manage to get this, I don't see Sigma going to be able to successfully do anything for the rest of this game, because Tanker is nowhere close to a Scythe Vice. So there's no lockdown on this Morphling like they want it to be. Yeah. But Morphling didn't want to commit to bottom lane. He's going to go back out and keep farming. And he can buy his Ghost Scepter right now if he like, which would be pretty decent, because when your Lincoln Sphere is off, and then you feel a little afraid of the Roar coming your way, you just Ghost Scepter and you'll be A-okay. The top lane right now. Looks like they want to crack at Morphling, but
they
don't
kill
think
him.
He can do it.
They can't kill him. Even with like hookshot initiation into a Roar, they don't have enough following burst damage to get the kill.
Yeah, they really don't right now, and it's a difficult position for them to be, because they can't really go bottom lane and force a fight against the Invoker, nor they can gank this Morphling.
They shouldn't force any fights. Like, right now, it should still come down to split push.
Yeah, you're right on that, but it's so hard to split push against this Invoker. Like, look at it. He's just waiting for you to farm.
And if you don't, then he'll take your tower. And they're going to find someone at least. Smile's over here on the corner. Fader's not jumping up. In fact, he's going to jump down instead because he's still at a fault. That was an easier kill. I say easier kill. It's not an easy kill, but it's an easier kill.
Yeah, and even Smile has Blink Dagger. Oh, this is getting scary in the middle right now. Fader being pinged out.
Sigma could find themselves being eliminated from the TKO if they can't get control of this game quickly. The control of gold is already 6-7k. Going the way of VirtusPro. Experience is racking up to about 10k as well. Like, I know the power of split push with the Tinker and the initiation of the clockwork with his hookshot, but they really need VP to screw up badly. And NS, well, they can't get this kill right now. Miguel, he's already used the hookshot, and NS just pushed away by the four staff of Sergei. And they're still pinging it out. The rocket! NS went down to 8 life points behind the tower. And he's trying to hide it out. Clockwork will have one more chance in 4 seconds' time. But top lane, Illidan takes the tier 2 up here.
4K gold.
He's going to get his Eagle Horn, and he's only 800 away from his Ethereal Blade. I mean, this is going to be not even a pre-25. It's going to be like a 23-minute Ethereal Blade we're looking at here. Oh, man. And MS slimping back towards base.
Yeah, I was watching him and watching that rocket from Clockwork. And I got a funny feeling Miguel could have one last shot. Yep, there's your Hawk already spotting out Jotam. Familiar's coming in too, Fader. He won't want to roar this, just axes would be enough. Oh, wait, whoa, we had to. The axes were the smallest axes I've ever seen. I think that was a bit of a misclick with his movement as well as axes. But either way, they're still going to kill on the Crystal Maiden.
Yeah, nonetheless, a kill is a kill. But quite a bit of commitment. Illidan. He's just free farming this lane. Like, no one can really go up against him. Mm-hmm. Like, the tanker can try his best, but if tanker caught out by a waveform after his blink, and an adaptive strike is definitely going to be
Clockwork.
The end of his life.
But jumps bottom lane. He's going on Smile, but Smile's got a Hood of Defiance, plus his Kraken Shell buff up, and in comes Illidan. Just pounds the Clockwork out.
And Poss is getting pinged out. They realize this, and he's gonna go down as well, and this is gonna be Illidan's Ethereal Blade.
He's 7-0-2 right now. 22 minutes in, and almost level 16 Morphling is just bearing down on top of Sigma. And you're right, it's an E-Blade, the Ghost Scepter's on the way out, and still he's able to have 640 gold walking through the March of the Machines.
Yeah, I'm not too sure about that, if that's the right play or not, but he's morphing all agility right now, and we are looking at someone melting from 100 to 0.
Oh,
is it going to be Mad?
There's a target right now. Yeah, Mad's
target acquired.
Oh, there goes your tornado dead to start with, and boom, boom. The shotgun has arrived for VirtusPro, while the ALT flies top lane to keep Fader off their tier 1 tower. VP are playing a really good game of Dota right now.
Yeah, and we see that was approximately 1,000 damage coming out from Morphling right now. So he can easily solo up every single hero on Sigma, probably besides the Visage, because of the Grave Keeper's Cloak can be quite effective at the burst damage. Right now, God is Invis walking up to Fader right now. If he's not too careful, Fader is going to go down.
He's almost there, and there he comes. Call snap to start with. He's changed himself up too, so the tornado is now available. Fader will at least be able to evade that one, but then Morphling, replicate, jump in. It is a godlike streak for Illidan. And for those guys right now who are watching with the TKO in-game tickets, if you keep watching Illidan, you might keep receiving res. 9-0 to 186 CS. And there's more fighting about to happen on bottom lane. This is probably the last all-in from Sigma. They're coming in for the 3 euros. It's a wonderful hookshot into a two-man cog. Macropire's on the edge, but the A ulti and the Ravage just buying the space for VirtusPro. Beastmaster already bought back into this game, so they will be able to pick up a couple of kills here, but it's still going to come at a price. Morphling's on his way in, and they can't control him. Smile is anchor smashing and waiting as long as he possibly can. In comes Sergei. There's your first tornado. Miss actually on every single hero, but there's no mana left for W33. Fader's in the corner. The mana burns on his way in too. Morphling just sniped out the Jakiro, and that was inside the Radiant base.
Yeah, they're losing their base right now, and God misses every single one, but no big deal. Morphling is salvaging the game right now. And GG from Fader. He's had enough.
Yeah, and that GG signifies the departure of Sigma from the TKO tournament. VP, of course, also joined them. VP will end their run with the results 2-5. And Sigma will have their results wrapping up tonight with exactly the same score. So we have both NextKZ, Sigma, as well as VP. They all end on exactly the same score, 2-5. But that means they are eliminated from the TKO tournament. And there is only one last match to play, man. Because this is actually the end of Stage 1. If you didn't know that tonight, this is the end of Stage 1. Stage 1 ends this evening. And that'll be Na'Vi going up against Team Empire. And really, that just comes down to a battle for who takes the bonus points. If Na'Vi can win this, we have a three-way tie across the number one position, so the bonus points will be split accordingly. But that's basically all it comes down to. If Na'Vi end up losing the game, Team Empire will take the maximum amount of bonus points. And then for our last games coming up from TKO America, Cloud9, the undefeated champions of the U.S. so far, will face up against the other undefeated champions of the U.S. so far. They are both sitting at 5-0 right now, so Cloud9 and Sad Boys will both play their final games for tonight, and if one of these teams loses both, then they draw themselves up with Team Liquid. Lose one, win the other, we could find ourselves still with a 6-1 tie across the board, but it's an interesting situation. Check out the details over at mlg.joindota.com. And as far as our next game goes, it is meant to be Na'Vi going up against Team Empire. Obviously, Na'Vi are still playing over in the D2CL, so I'll get back to you in a couple of moments' time letting you know what's going to happen with our next game. For now, though, we'll go to a short break, and I'll come back with more info in just a bit.